Sustainable Agriculture Research and Education. It's a national program that's funded by USDA. We're a grant and education program, so we give out grants through our five programs: farmer rancher, youth educator, graduate student, research and education, and professional development. If you want to find out more about SARE, go to our national website, www.sare.org, S-A-R-E.org. You can click on project reports and see reports from all of the presentations that have been here, and unless they're so new that they haven't put a report up yet. So great resource for you, and also information about all of our grant programs in case you're interested in applying. So right now I'm going to introduce Shirron LeShure. She's going to graduate student grant recipient, and she's going to talk about her project and using Grape, Pomace as a natural dewormer in sheep.
So good afternoon, everybody. I'm just going to share basically a brief snippet of my dissertation research that I've been doing over the last year, looking at grape pomace. I'll explain what that is a little more in the presentation, as a natural dewormer for sheep. So just an overview of what my talk will be about. I'll give you an introduction and background, briefly why I did this, what's the problem, things at hand, some preliminary research that helped strengthen why we wanted to move a step further in doing this research. My SARE project overview, the results and discussion, and then we'll go over some general conclusions. So the introduction and background, I'll give you background on gastrointestinal parasites, natural products in medicine and agriculture, and what grape pomace is. So gastrointestinal paroxysm, or GIP, has become a concern in the U.S. and globally because we have parasites that are becoming resistant to current commercial conventional deworming methods. This is mostly because of an increase of reassortment of certain genetic material within those parasites and also misuse of amplimentic. Some farmers don't really know how much to use or when to use it or aren't giving exact amounts. So that's also increased the resistance within those animals. As well as with sheep and goats, there's a limited number of drugs that are actually approved by the FDA for those animals to get rid of intestinal parasites. So the issue that comes up is small ruminants are actually the ones that are having the most issue with resistance and gastrointestinal paroxysm. So there are common alternatives to chemical amplimentics that are out there to control gastrointestinal parasites, such as breeding to genetically resistant animals, animals that are naturally resistant to getting infected and dealing with the point of disease. Also proper pasture management, making sure your pastures don't get overgrazed, making sure that you have proper pasture rotation between your animals, as well as not overcrowding your fields, not having too many animals on those fields. That can increase the spread of and transmission of those parasites to more animals when you do that. And there are also natural worming methods, which I will talk about in this presentation. So just to give you an outlook, this right here is actually a dewdrop. In this dewdrop are parasitic larvae. There can be up to 1,000 larvae within just a dewdrop on a blade of grass. So just to give you some background on how the transmission and how it occurs, you have the larvae that are in the dewdrop on a blade of grass. You have your sheep or goat come, and because they're browsers, they're going to nibble off the top more so than just pulling straight up and grazing, and they ingest those larvae. Once they ingest it, the larvae will go into several other stages before they become adults. They will reproduce and produce eggs that come out in the fecal matter, which is put back on the field. Those eggs in the fecal matter will then develop into other larvae stages and eating organic material until they get to a free living stage, which is the third stage larvae that become infective that are on that blade of grass, and then you have the cycle start all over again. So this is just a list of common parasites in ruminants, with the strongyloid parasites being the most important, which includes ostentaria, or a brown stomach worm. You have humongous contortus, which is also called the barber pole worm, and also trichostrongylus, which is the bankrupt worm. Other parasites that are not worms, per se, and other parasites that are worms that are harmful and that farmers are worried about are coccidia, which causes coccidiosis in your sheep and goats and cattle, as well as tapeworm. So getting back to natural products and medical uses, natural products are basically those chemicals, compounds derived from living organisms, plants, animals, or insects that have some type of biological activity. They help in some way, but they just come from natural sources. So natural products in agriculture has become a growing interest because it's a new way to control those GIP or parasites in small ruminants. There's also a public perception that residues from chemical dewormers are left in the meat, so more people are wanting to go to natural products or go to looking at different alternatives. It's not necessarily true, but it's part of propaganda. There are also limited to no commercial anthelmintic use with organic farming practices, so going natural also helps with controlling those parasites that are on organic farms. And there's also an increasing economic benefit in both plant and animal industries when you're able to reuse waste products or reuse certain agricultural products in a way that will help benefit not only your animals, but help you get more money in your pocket. So some compounds or interest that we've seen in natural products that are out in the literature are condensed tannins, flavonoids, and antioxidants. So condensed tannins are just a chemical that's in plants, that's a plant secondary metabolite that just basically has been shown in certain research as to increase absorption of essential amino acids in the small intestine, and also that would lead to increased wool growth, body mass, milk production, and the amount of protein in the milk. Now this is actually due to the fact that condensed tannins will make a complex and bind with proteins during mastication or eating, and then when they are able to pass through the gut so they don't get broken down, and they're able to disassociate, so you're getting more protein to the small intestines that will benefit the animal. It's also been shown to counteract protein losses caused by gut paroxysm and stimulate the immune system with that extra protein that's available. Other research has shown that it's inactivated parasite larvae during the passage through the gut as well. Flavonoids have been shown to paralyze the parasite so it's able to be passed through the gut naturally and does not have a chance to attach or find its preferential niche. It also inhibits eggs from hatching, which would decrease transmission. And you also have a decrease of parasites expressing that multi-drug resistance and basically changing their genes so that they can become drug resistant. And antioxidants work in animals as they work with us. They are a way to scavenge for radicals within the body, and they help increase immune function so the animal is able to fight off the infection naturally. So it helps with that resilience to parasite infection. So grape pomace. Basically, Ohio grape industry consists of about greater than 1,500 acres of vineyards producing 1.5 to 4 tons per acre since 2004 within the state. Grape pomace itself is what's left over after juice and wine making, so it's the seeds, the stems, the skins, and the pulp that's left over. And wine grape pomace has shown to have high levels of flavonoids and up to 4% of condensed tannin, which I just stated in the previous slide, helps with gastrointestinal paroxysm and has shown some type of efficacy. So with these compounds being in grape pomace, it's why we wanted to look into it. So several animal studies have actually looked at grape pomace as utilizing as an animal feed, but not necessarily at the parasite level that I'm looking at. And what they saw was there's only a marginal amount of digestibility lowered when you pair it with other things. So if you were to put grape pomace in your feed that has alfalfa hay or sorghum hay in it, what you'll get is you don't have a lower digestibility. It still pretty much stays the same within 1.6%. And when given in moderation, up to 10% of the diet being grape pomace, it can actually help in fattening your lambs. So getting on to the next part of my talk, which is a preliminary study that I did with USDA Agricultural Research Services in Beltsville, Maryland. And what we did was we took Shiraz and Cabernet Sauvignon wine grape pomace from a vineyard, local vineyard here in Ohio in Madison. We dried those samples and ground them and then extracted them with alcohol so that we could get those active compounds of interest that I discussed earlier, and then dried off the ethanol and actually put it in a saline solution, which is a salt water solution. We looked at those third stage larvae of the brown stomach worm in an exsheathed state, which means we took their outer cuticle off to simulate more what would be in the body when, before they transition to the next stage larvae. And we used about 100 larvae per treatment well. We looked at them at 0, 2, 4, and 24 hours after introduction of the extract on those parasites. And the larvae were assessed for how they moved, how well were they alive, were they sick, were they inactive, and were they dead. So this is just a tabular version of my results, looking at the activity at two different concentrations of the Shiraz or the Cabernet Sauvignon grapes. There was actually no difference within concentration, but we saw there was a decrease of almost 49 to 50% within 4 hours of those worms being in the extract. And with it, there was no difference in the results between 4 and 24 hours. And at the actual Cabernet Sauvignon grapes had a higher efficacy of about 51% versus 48% reduction in activity of the Shiraz grapes. And that was mostly due to there being a higher level of condensed tannin within the Cabernet Sauvignon grapes than the Shiraz. But that was all relative to a control that only decreased about 20%. So when you look at that overall, you're able to see that the extracts of the wine grape pomace actually showed some efficacy in decreasing the overall health and viability of those parasite larvae. And there was no difference, like I said, between concentrations, but there was difference from the control. So this led us to our next studies, which was we saw there's some efficacy with wine grapes on the parasite themselves. So what happens when we look at them in the animal? We also did fecal culture, which was to look how those extracts would be on the eggs that are in the feces, so to help with break that cycle of transmission that I talked about earlier. So with the animal trials, the first trial, we used 54 growing lambs that were naturally infected. They were tested for the level of infection that they had before they were assigned to treatment groups. There were three treatment groups in the first trial. We wanted to test it against a commercial dewormer such as Cydectin. We wanted to test it against also the grape pomace that we formulated in a diet that we gave in a 5-day dose that would give about 28 grams of condensed tannin per kilogram of dry matter. So we also wanted to test both of those next to a negative control, which means they were given nothing. These animals are just living as is, eating regular normal feed. And with the grape pomace feed, it was only fed, like I said, for 5 days, and then they went on a normal diet like the rest of the animals. They were assessed for body weight, average daily gain, feed intake, packed cell volume, and fomacha, which would help assess the anemia score, and the number of eggs per gram within their fecals, also known as fecal egg counts. Trial two, we came up with after trial one. It was a little different in the beginning when we wrote it out, but due to the results that we got from trial one, our next step was to look at a dose titration of grape pomace in the diet. So the treatment, so we still have 54 animals, a different set of lambs that we put in three treatment groups. There's that negative control again, that's given nothing. Then we had a middle ground, which is given about 2 pounds per head of the grape pomace diet. That gave that same 28 grams of condensed tannin per kilogram of dry matter, but it was supplemented with 1.25 pounds of alfalfa pellet. So what their normal feed would be, we're just giving it in a lower dosage than the next treatment group, which was a 3.25 pounds per head of grape pomace that gave a dose of 45 grams of condensed tannin per kilogram of dry matter. We also assessed them for the same parameters as the first trial. So with trial one, there was actually no difference between treatments with the body weight, average daily gain, or feed intake. We did see an increase in body weight, which is expected for growing lambs as the weeks progressed. The average weight gain over the 21-day period was about 6.8 pounds, give or take 0.3 pounds per lamb. The average daily gain for the different treatment groups was about 0.17 pounds for the ones given Cydectin. 0.33 pounds for those that were given nothing or a negative control, and 0.32 pounds for those given the grape pomace. The packed cell volumes, or the red blood cells that help us determine anemia, decreased over time But overall, it was highest for the positive control. There was no difference between the negative control and the grape pumice treatment. So with that being said, the packed cell volume was at around 28, and usually you want to deworm your animals when you see that packed cell volume drop to or below 20. With the Furmancha, which is a observational examination of anemia within those animals, there was no difference between treatment. It stayed relatively high around 2. The highest is 1, 5 being the lowest. You usually try to deworm around 3 or lower, and that corresponds to a packed cell volume of below 20. So you have what you can assess on farm, the Furmancha, what you can assess in the lab, the packed cell volume. Fecal egg counts was actually lowest for the cydectin treatment, and there was no difference between the negative control or the grape pumice treatment. They were actually relatively high. They didn't really change much during the trial, but you expect cydectin to bring the fecal egg count down. The surprising result that came up, cydectin should bring the amount of eggs per gram of feces down below 100 when it's working properly, and it did not in our positive group. And that was a bit of a problem on our farm because that means there was increasing resistance occurring in those lambs to a commercial dewormer. So that's what led into the next trial, which was, let's see if we can give more condensed tannins and if we can bring the egg count down and see some type of dose response. So in trial 2, there was, once again, no difference between treatments for body weight, average daily gain, or feed intake. The body weight still increased over the weeks that progressed as they grew. The average weight gain over 21 days was a little higher at 7.7 pounds, and the average daily gain was highest for the grape pumice that was supplemented with alfalfa, and the next after that was the negative control, the lowest being the group given a grape pumice diet at the highest concentration. The packed cell volumes in these animals increased over time, but there was still no difference between treatments. And the Furmancha scores actually stayed slightly higher. There was no difference between treatments at all, and it stayed around 1 to 1.5, so generally healthy animals. The fecal egg count showed no difference between treatments, but the middle ground diet, the grape pumice that was supplemented with the alfalfa, actually had a tendency to reduce the fecal egg counts, which was a bit of a surprise to us because your hypothesis would be more condensed tannins, you would expect a lower fecal egg count instead of the middle ground. But what came when I did further analysis, I realized that there was actually more protein given with the second diet of the grape pumice and alfalfa supplement. So when you're increasing the protein and you have the condensed tannin, you have a positive interaction happening that by increasing that nutrient value, you're able to decrease the egg count and give the animals a little more to help fight the infection and decrease the amount of fecal eggs. So moving on to the next part of the study, which was the fecal culture, and this was looking at adding the extract to the infected poop itself that had the eggs in it. We wanted to include farmers, so I went to 5 farms, 3 conventional and 2 organic farms to collect the poop from their herd of sheep. We did 2 treatments, looking at giving them nothing, just mixing poop and water, doing a normal larval development type culture, and also we used grape pumice at 38 milligrams of condensed tannin per milliliter. And that dose was decided on how much condensed tannin would be undigested left in the poop after that highest dose diet of the 45 grams of condensed tannin per kilogram of dry matter. And we looked at basically was there a presence or in the presence or absence of those extracts, did the eggs hatch into larvae? So what we actually saw was that the fecal cultures that were done in the extracts actually had kept eggs from hatching or developing at 100% inhibition. No eggs hatched whatsoever when compared to the controls. There was no difference in the effective extracts between farms. So it didn't matter whether they used commercial amphimentic and they were seeing resistance on a conventional farm, or they weren't using any dewormers at all on an organic farm. We saw no difference in treatment between the farms, meaning that the condensed the extract worked regardless of farming practice. One of just an observational but not quantifiable result that I saw was there was no fungus or mold that grew with the culture and the ones given the extract, which was kind of interesting to know that it had some type of antifungal or antimicrobial effect, and it also decreased the smell of the poop. You gotta love that when you're working with poop. It doesn't smell like poop anymore. So some general conclusions and what's next. The effects of wine grape pumice have an efficacy on parasites. We saw that looking at the extract from the larvae directly. The next step would be in looking, does this work against humongous consortive or the barbacole worm? Does it work against the bankrupt worm? Does it work against coccidia or tapeworm? So looking at other parasites that affect ruminants, will it help with those parasites as well? Remember, we only looked at the brown stomach worm, as well as looking to see if we can pull out specific things in those extracts instead of just using a crude extract to see exactly what compound is causing this efficacy. We also, with the in vivo studies, they were inconclusive. This was mostly because the number of animals we had may have been too small, so we need to increase our replication in order to actually see a significant result from our treatment groups. But also, when looking at the grape pumice diet when compared to a normal alfalfa diet, it was a lot lower in nutrient value. It had the same energy, but it didn't necessarily give the same amount of nutrients and vitamins and minerals. So formulating a grape pumice diet that has the optimum nutrition range and the optimum amount of condensed tannin would be beneficial in the next step in doing another animal trial. Also, the fecal cultures provided insight into decreasing the transmission on farms. If it's not allowing the eggs to hatch, it's not allowing transmission to occur, so you could then even use the extracts themselves or use the grape pumice into the diet for a few days to try to inactivate the eggs, deworm your animals, and then see if you can decrease the amount of transition. Because the problem that occurs is you have constant reinfection happening. So you may only have one or two sheep that are highly infected and a few of them that are fighting off resistance, but because they're overshedding eggs in their what they call super shedders, what are happening, you have one or two that are infecting your entire herd over and over and over again. So just helping to see if there can be other studies that can be done to help add grape pumice to the diet to decrease the amount of transmission. So here are the references for the information that I've given you. Are there any questions or comments? Yes, ma'am.
Grape can be toxic to dogs, and the principal substance hasn't been identified, but it results in kidney failure. Do you know if anybody's looked at kidney function or anything in sheep to see if there's any possible toxicity to grape feed?
Okay, so to make sure I understand your question, your question is that in there are certain things or compounds in grapes themselves that are toxic to dogs, and you want to know, has anybody looked at it into these agricultural animals to see if there's toxicity within the kidneys? No, I have not seen anything out there about that. The other difference is the way things are metabolized in a dog or a non-ruminant animal are completely different as how they're metabolized or digested into a ruminant animal. So that may be another way that it's not really affecting kidney function that anybody has seen so far, if that helps answer your question. Anyone else? Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, could you explain again how you took the grape pumice and ground it down and what the process was?
So the question is that, could I just explain further what was the process that I used to get this extract? Is that correct? Okay, so what I actually did is collected the wine grape pumice fresh from the vineyard, brought it back. The vineyard is Dubon Vineyards in Madison, Ohio.
Yeah, what did you extract? What did you
take? It's not from the grapevines. It's a wine grape pumice. It's basically the wine grapes have already been taken, harvested,
yes,
crushed, fermented for about a week, and we're getting after you spin off that liquid on the first fermentation. So we're getting the waste that's left over.
Okay.
Right, so it'd be like distiller's grains, if that makes sense. So it's the waste that's left over. It's not actual agricultural product, if that makes sense. Does that help better?
Yeah.
All right, so after that, we dried it to about 95% dry matter. And then we took subsamples of our large group, because we actually got about a half a ton of this grape pumice for our subsequent studies. So we dried it down once it was dry to above 95% dry matter. We ground it in a Wiley mill to pass through a 2-millimeter sieve, and then took a 70% aqueous ethanol solution, which is basically 70% ethanol, 30% water, with vitamin C added to help keep the compounds in it from oxidizing. We wanted to make sure we kept our compounds active, and extracted over 24 hours. So basically set the dry grape pomace in that mixture, let it mix for 24 hours in the solution, and then after that, we basically took off the liquid portion, threw away the solids, and evaporated off all the alcohol, and then resuspended it in a salt solution so that it would not harm the larvae themselves. Now, as far as the animal studies, it was put in a diet, so the grape pomace was not extracted at all.
I was going to say, how would a producer actually do that practically?
Right. So you have to understand with the extracts, that's bench work. That's the research in the lab that I need to look to see, is it working against the parasites out of the body? When it comes to the practicality of using grape pomace, you would basically get the waste material from a vineyard, and you, when you sent it off to get your diet formulated, it would be incorporated into your diet. So eventually, hopefully, it'll be commercially available. But until that happens, basically what's happening is they're taking the raw material and mixing it in as a feed additive. So like they would do alfalfa hay or your Vitamix or your animal fat or your minerals, trace minerals. You're just adding it as a part of the ration itself.
Would it be a daily part of the ration, or would it be treatment?
So the way I look at it, I think it would be something that is a little bit of both. So it's a daily treatment for a given amount of days, until you start to see the decrease. And then the reason we looked at that was there an extended effect? And there was. So just that 5-day dose would be enough, or 7 days would be enough, and then you continue to use your natural or whatever your normal feed would be after
and that's,
that.
And that's where the kind of the hiccup when it comes to organic certification would be, is because if you're going to feed it daily long term, it has to be certified organic. So now
right.
It has to be certified organic grapes.
Right.
To go from there. If it's a treatment, rule of thumb for OPA, we don't do treatments anymore than 2 weeks. 2 weeks, beyond 2 weeks, you're now, that's part of the daily ration, it's no longer a treatment. So it would be something that would need to be in consideration for anyone who's certified, you know, how does that treat that?
Right. And that's why we looked at it as a 5-day dose, is what we looked at, and that, you know, it did have an extended effect, so you could do it once a month for about a week or a business week, and then you should be able to still see some type of efficacy within your herd. Is there any other questions? One more? No, thank you for your attention. I appreciate it.